Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the Foreign Correspondents Club of Japan. My name is Khaldun Azhari. I'm a member of the club, and I might be one of the victims of the next month's tax increase to 8%, because I read so many reports by economists that this will lead to very negative consequences on the Japanese economy and consumption and exports, everything. And that's why everybody is looking how the Prime Minister of Japan and the Governor, Bank of Japan Governor, are going to steer the economy in that time. So a lot of economists talk about that, and they called for more monetary easing to cushion that tax increase. But our guest speaker today thinks otherwise. And he urged the central bank to disengage from this unprecedented stimulus and or risk surging borrowing that caused that could fuel a collapse of confidence in the nation's fiscal sustainability. He also says that Japan is at the risk of falling into the QE trap of being unable to wind down the easing because of concerns over yield spike. Our guest speaker also is known to be coining the term balance sheet recession to describe the aftermath of bursting of Japan's asset bubble in the early 90s. In his new Japanese language book, he also think that talk about this problem spreading throughout the global economy. Our guest speaker was a former Federal Reserve economist, and who he wrote also the very famous book, The Holy Grail of Macroeconomics, Lessons from Japan's Great Recession. And he advised successive Japanese prime ministers and government officials to deal with Japan's economic and banking problems. Ladies and gentlemen, without more explanation, let me introduce to you our guest speaker, Mr. Richard Gu. Thank you.
Good afternoon. Thank you for coming to this session. I'm very much honored to be back at FCCJ. I really wanted to talk about Europe today, because Europe is making all the mistakes that Japan made, and they seem to refuse to learn from the Japanese experience, whereas the Americans and many of the policymakers there read my book, understood what was going on, and are doing all the right things. But I understand that you are all stationed in Japan as a foreign correspondent. So you cannot talk about Europe, so let me start speaking about Japan. Abenomics that got so much attention in the press last year, it seems to be losing some of its momentum. And if you look at the stock market, you know, every time something goes wrong, Japanese stock market falls further than anyone else's. And when the good news comes, the Japanese economy, stock market recovers less than in some other markets for the last couple of months. And people are wondering what's actually happening, or what's going on with Abenomics and all the momentum that people had great hopes in. Now, Abenomics had a very, very lucky start. And that is that when it was announced December of now 2 years ago, all these foreigners got very excited. And they came in massively into the Japanese stock market, pushed the stock market 80% higher, pushed the Japanese yen 20% lower, and changed the entire landscape of Japan, which those of us in Japan are, of course, extremely grateful. Because if you look at what the Japanese investors were doing, they were all in the bond market. And the fact that they were in the bond market actually kept the interest rates low, and that made it even easier for foreign investors to buy more Japanese stocks or sell Japanese yen. But why was this big difference between the foreign perception of Japan and the Japanese perception of Japan? Well, it all started, I think, with this chart. This chart shows, the charts you have are abridged version of what's in here. And I just changed it last minute so that if I do get a question on Europe, I can answer it. This chart shows how much reserves a banking system relative to required reserves. And if the required reserves, the amount of reserves in the banking system is exactly equal to the required reserves, the number will be one. And that's the usual world in most monetary policy, most countries. Required reserves and reserves actually in the banking system are more or less the same amount. But if the number is bigger than one, that means the central bank is trying to ease the monetary policy, then that means there'll be more reserves than required by all sorts of reserve requirements. And if you look at this chart, you'll notice that Bank of Japan did the first quantitative easing in history. When it was pressured by many foreign academics as well as the Japanese politicians that if you just print money, everything will be fine. So BOJ did the first QE in history from 2001 to 2006, increased it to 7 times the required reserves, but nothing happened. You know, if you increase the reserves 7 times, you're supposed to have 7 times more money supply, 700% inflation rate, nothing like that happened. So 2006, they said, well, it didn't work, so they rescinded it. Then in 2008, when the Lehman shock hit, Federal Reserve did a massive quantitative easing, and now there's enough reserves in the US banking system to increase money supply by 19 times. So we're potentially facing 1900% inflation rate in the United States, but of course nothing like that is happening. If anything, inflation rate in the United States is coming down. And the UK also did a massive one here, which pushed it to 10.6 times. But UK, instead of having economic growth, they actually experienced the double dip. Some people even call it triple dip. Only in the last 6 months that UK economy is beginning to pick up. And so many Japanese investors experiencing their own QE first from 2001 to 2006, and looking at what happened in other countries, said, well, there's no reason for this policy to work. So they stayed home. And there's a reason behind why these policies did not produce the results. If you look at the monetary aggregates in more detail, here I have monetary base, money supply, and loan and credit to the banking system. And what we learn in universities, if you remember your economics, is that these three are supposed to move together. That is to say, if the central bank increases monetary base by 10%, eventually money supply, credit to the private sector increasing by 10%. And that world did exist before the Lehman shock, three lines moving together. But after the Lehman shock, Federal Reserve increased the monetary base to 453, starting from 100 at the time of Lehman shock. But the money supply, that's the amount of money we actually get to spend. That's our bank, the aggregate of our bank accounts. It's only increased to 143, and credit to the private sector, 101. What is the credit? Why is the credit to the private sector important? Credit to the private sector is important because the central bank can add all the reserves in the banking system. But whether that money comes out of the banking system to the actual economy or not, the bank has to lend this money. Bank cannot give this money away. If they give it away, you'll be sitting on a huge non-performing loans. So it has to lend money. And this green line shows how much money actually came out of the banking system. And the fact that the number is 101 means most of the money that was put into the financial market really didn't come out of the financial market. It stayed in the financial market. And as a result, with that funds not circulating, US inflation rate kept on coming down instead of going up. And this is the European situation, same story, three lines moving together. And then European Central Bank, this is LTRO1, LTRO2. They did all of that. But if you look at where the money supply is, it's 108, credit to the private sector, 99, and still falling, which is not a very good sign at all. And this is the UK, same story. UK, the credit to the private sector is actually 85. That means 15% less than where it was at the time of the Lehman shock, and no wonder the economy is still struggling. And that's the world we experienced in Japan for the last 25 years. This is a much longer time period, starting from 1985. And during the bubble days, three lines moved beautifully together, as we learn in schools. And a few years after the bubble, well, more or less the same. But then the three began to diverge. Bank of Japan, under political and other pressures, kept on doing quantitative easing. Now it's 575 relative to 100 at year 1990. But money supply grew to only 186, credit to the private sector 108. 108 means that was the level 20 years ago. And as a result, no pickup in inflation. Sometimes we quoted with deflation instead. And why do we get this effect? We get this because of the bursting of the bubble. When the bubble burst, first of all, during the bubble, how do people behave? Well, they borrow lots of money to invest in all sorts of assets, thinking that they're going to make tons of money with higher leverage. And then the bubble bursts, asset prices collapse, liabilities remain, and a large part of the private sector realizes that its balance sheets are actually underwater. Underwater means these guys are all bankrupt. But if you're bankrupt, what do? You try to come out of your bankruptcy, right? Whether formally or informally, you try to clean up your balance sheets. How do you clean up your balance sheets? You either increase savings or pay down debt, which is basically the same thing. And these people will not borrow money at any interest rates. In fact, there won't be any lenders to these guys either if lenders know that the borrowers are bankrupt. And furthermore, if the lenders themselves have the balance sheet problems. And so you enter a very different world where private sector is no longer maximizing profits. They're actually minimizing debt once the bubble bursts. And that's the world that I'm afraid economics profession have more or less overlooked all the way until fairly recently. Now, this shows what happened to the Japanese bubble and the US bubbles 15 years apart. And you can see that both on the way up and on the way down, they moved remarkably together. So US basically have the same problem Japan encountered. Now, most recently, US house prices began to appreciate, whereas the Japanese one kept on going down. And I can refer to this issue if we have time a little later. And this is the European house prices. And Europe, as many of you from Europe are aware, had a massive housing bubble as well. If we take 1995 as 100, and Irish prices went to 514, Greek prices went to 342, Spain 303. But what's remarkable about this chart is not just the size of the European housing bubble, but what happened to German house prices during the same period. With the same monetary policy, same central bank, the German house prices actually fell 10% during this period. And this is one of the reasons why we have a problem in Europe today. And if I get to it, I would love to discuss about this issue as well. Now, what happens when the housing bubble goes? Oh, sorry, these are not in your charts. So, when the bubble goes, everyone start paying down debt all at the same time. And this chart shows the Japanese part of that problem. This is taken from the data called flow of funds. And I'm sure those of you who study economics or work in a central bank are aware of this chart, but let me explain how this chart is put together. There's a horizontal line going across at zero. Above zero, financial surplus, other people saving money. Below zero are the people who are borrowing and investing money. And there are four lines here: government line, corporate line, rest of the world, and the households. If you add the four lines together, you're supposed to get zero. That's how these charts are put together. And if you look at the Japanese corporate line, the blue line here, during the bubble days, these guys are borrowing like crazy, investing in all sorts of assets, golf club memberships, real estate, whatever the case may be. And then once the bubble burst and asset prices start collapsing, their fund procurement began to shrink very rapidly. From 1998 onwards, it's been in the positive range. What does it mean, positive range? It means the corporate sector as a whole is paying down debt at zero interest rates. And we never learn in universities that companies are supposed to pay down debt at zero interest rates, right? And they're supposed to be borrowing money and investing. But because they have such a horrendous balance sheets, they had to repair their balance sheets. And so they were all paying down debt. And that situation continues to this day. Now, once you have this kind of situation, economy is in a very sad shape, because in a national economy, if someone is saving money or paying down debt, you better have someone on the other side borrowing and spending money. And in a usual world, it's the financial sector. People like Nomura or Bank of America, Citibank, those people in the financial sector taking the money from the savers, giving to someone who can use it. And if there are too many borrowers, interest rates are raised. Too few borrowers, interest rates are lowered. Make sure that all the saved funds are borrowed and spent. That's how economy moves forward. But in this situation, at zero interest rates, both the household sector and corporate sector are above zero. Above zero means everybody's paying down debt or saving money. Then what happens? All the saved funds that comes into the banking system, all the deleveraged funds that are coming back into the banking system, they cannot leave the banking system because there are no borrowers even at zero interest rates. So what happens? The money gets stuck in the banking system. It can't come out. The economy starts shrinking by the amount of funds that are stuck in the banking system. If I may give you a numerical example, let's say I have $1,000 of income. I decide to spend $900 myself. That $900 is already someone else's income, so that's not a problem. The $100 that I decide to save will go through the banking system, given to someone who can use it. That person borrows and spends it. And so you have $900 plus $100, $1,000 against my original income of $1,000, and the economy moves forward. If there are too many borrowers, rates are raised. Too few borrowers, rates are lowered. But in this situation, when what happens? If I have $1,000 of income, I spend $900 myself, $100 that I decide to save, that $100 gets stuck in the banking system because there are no borrowers even at zero interest rates. So only $900 is spent. That becomes someone else's income. That person says, okay, let's save 10%. Then $810 will be spent, the $90 go into the banking system, and that $90 gets stuck again because this process goes on for more than 10 years. So you end up in the situation where economy starts shrinking from 1,900, 810, 730 very, very quickly with zero interest rates, when the private sector as a group is deleveraging like this. And the last time something like that actually happened was the Great Depression in the United States from 1929 onwards, where everybody was deleveraging, no one was borrowing money, and the United States lost 46% of its GDP in just 4 years. Now, Japan managed to keep its GDP from collapsing because government was borrowing money. And if you look at this chart more carefully, you notice that around 2005, 2006, the line is almost ready to go below zero. And that was the time when people start saying, hey, Japanese corporate balance sheets are all repaired. Half of the Japanese listed companies have no debt at zero interest rates, which is a problem in itself, of course. And I was really hoping that this line will go below zero, and then we're back to the textbook world. No more in the world of what I call balance sheet recession, but you know, private sector maximizing profits again. Then the Lehman Brothers collapsed. Japanese, knowing what is coming in the future, went into the massive defensive here. And even though the tsunami and earthquake brought this number down a little bit, the blue line is still above zero, nearly 3% of GDP. And if you add the households and companies together, private sector in Japan is still saving 8% of GDP at zero interest rates, which means if no one's borrowing that 8%, outside the private sector, this economy will be shrinking 8% at this very moment. Now, if that's the reality that we have to start with, how is Abenomics trying to address this issue? Well, I think there are two reasons why people are still not borrowing money at 0% interest rates, why the companies are not borrowing money at zero interest rates. One is the trauma toward debt. And this trauma toward debt is what many people in the US, UK, and Europe will soon experience. And that is that once the private sector goes through an experience like this, repairing balance sheets under very difficult circumstances, they say to themselves, I never want to borrow money again. I never want to see those bankers again. So if there's some banker friends in this crowd, I'm sorry, but that's the way people typically react after experience like this. Americans who lived through the Great Depression never borrowed money until they died because the trauma was so bad. Now, Japan, we have the same problem. We went through this for 15 years. They said never again. Now, I think the Japanese problem is a mini version of the US problem in the sense that in the United States, GDP actually fell 46%. That means people had to pay down debt with 46% less income. That must have been living hell. In the Japanese case, because the government came in and borrowed that 8% and kept the GDP from collapsing, Japanese GDP never fell below the peak of the bubble in spite of all of that because of the government borrowing. That still took 15 years. And many companies are saying never again. And I'm sure many of you have heard this term, cash flow management, cash flow care. You know, sometimes it's very difficult to define what this particular word means, but it simply means do everything within the cash flow. Don't borrow money. And that's how many Japanese companies are operating. That's why the blue line is still above zero. Now, individually, I can understand why they feel that way. If I were running one of those companies, I'd probably think the same way as well. But as a national economy, if someone is saving money, you better have someone borrowing money. And you have to get these guys off the trauma. And so if you look at the Abenomics from this angle, you notice that a second arrow, which doesn't get much attention in the press, or if it does get attention in the press, it's usually in a bad light. This is more of the same, building bridges and roads to nowhere and blah, blah, blah. I would argue that this is the most important part of Abenomics by far. All these regions in Japan that are doing better than last year, those are the regions that are getting the fiscal stimulus. And the reason it is in there as a second arrow is because the people in the Abe administration finally understand that private sector in Japan is saving 8% of GDP at zero interest rates. And if you don't have a fiscal stimulus under the circumstances, the whole thing will collapse. So in that sense, it's good that they are proactive instead of always falling behind the curve. You know, all the previous administrations, of course, put in the fiscal stimulus, but that's only after the economy starts sinking. And then they do something to keep it from sinking further. This time, Abe administration is aware that given the situation of the private sector, we have to put in the fiscal stimulus. Now, there are actually two parts to the second arrow. First part is government borrowing and spending, which is already in full swing. And the second part is try to get these guys off the trauma. And what are they trying to do with it? They're trying to come up with accelerated depreciation allowances, investment tax credit to get these guys off the trauma. And these are modeled after what President Obama put in for year 2011. Remember in the United States, 2011, if you invest in during 2011, you can write everything off during 2011. That's the same package that this government is talking about. Now, I think those are very important, and this pinpoint approach to get these guys off the trauma, I think, is absolutely essential. But then someone else came up with the idea that, why don't we bring the corporate tax rates down as well? And when you think about it, if the people are having this trauma, bringing corporate tax rate doesn't help. In fact, it's better to have a high corporate tax rate and do the other things first, that you can write off everything during the same year, investment tax credit, because those measures were worth more if the corporate tax rate is higher. And if you bring a corporate tax rate lower, then these incentive measures are going to worth less. So the debate then went on among those people who understand this problem, saying, no, we don't do corporate tax rate now. And the other people said, well, just cut it. And that's where the debate is at the moment. But given that the Prime Minister actually said, let's bring the corporate tax rate down, I'm sure some of that will be reflected in some package when those things are announced. But if within the same budget, if you have to do corporate tax rates as well, then those measures to fight the trauma will be that much more smaller, and it may not be as aggressive as originally intended. So that's the little worry I have on this part. But the point is that they are not sitting still just spending money. They're trying to get these companies out of the trauma by coming up with incentive measures. Now, what's the other reason why Japanese companies are not borrowing money? Well, they're not borrowing money. The other reason they give is that, well, it's a shrinking economy, shrinking population, old age. There's no, the market is shrinking. Why invest here? We can invest somewhere else where the market is growing, there are plenty of workers to man the factories and so forth. Now that one, against this, what Abe is trying to do is, okay, let's do the structural reform, increase investment opportunities inside the country. Within the same framework, within the same legal framework, of course you cannot expect anything new, but if you change the legal framework drastically, then there might be opportunities for companies to invest. And a lot of people in the market, especially foreigners, got pretty wild with this idea of structural reform. Now, this structural reform that Abe is trying to put in my view, is the right set of structural reforms. And I say this because 7-8 years ago, it was Prime Minister Koizumi who talked about structural reform, and I was completely opposed to structural reforms. And I opposed it so much that I couldn't appear in Japanese television anymore. Why was I opposed to that structural reform? If you remember that structural reform, he was trying to privatize postal savings, the 230 trillion financial institutions lending money to the public sector. His point was that such a big financial institutions, this is a fully developed, mature capitalist economy, why should they should start lending to the private sector, not to the public sector? But I was against it because if you look at this chart, you notice that there are no private sector borrowers. Private sector is all saving money or deleveraging. So what's the point of increasing lenders when there are no borrowers? The critical, the most important missing piece in Japan is the lack of private sector borrowers. And against that, what Koizumi is trying to do, Prime Minister Abe is trying to do is to increase borrowers, not increase lenders, by deregulating agriculture, medical field, energy, healthcare, all of these areas that were very tightly controlled before. If they open these things up, there might be investment opportunities, and then people might then want to get into those activities. In the process, they'll start borrowing money. So this time, I think the structural reform is the right kind of structural reform for Japan. Now, is that structural reform going smoothly? Well, not the impression I get these days. I mean, politicians are all fully for it, but when they go through this bureaucratic process of actually putting together legislations, I understand that there's so much opposition from bureaucrats and elsewhere that they end up becoming smaller and smaller and smaller. You know, Japanese bureaucrats, they want to make sure that everything works perfectly from day one. And in order to make sure everything works perfectly from day one, any problem here, out of question. Any problem here, remove this. And then they start removing. At the end of the day, you have a very small pie. You know, the way American works is that, well, let's try it. And if the computer breaks down and Obamacare doesn't work, oh, sorry, and then fix the computer, right? That's a very different approach from the Japanese bureaucrats. And I wish this time maybe we could bring in some US-like thinking and just get the thing moving. And if we run into problems, we can fix that on the way. But that's not the way Japanese bureaucrats work, I'm afraid. And so we just have to make sure that the program doesn't get too small by the time it actually comes out. Now, how about the Arrow 1 that got all the attention of the press, especially of the market? Well, I think Arrow 1 got the greatest result imaginable. I think Mr. Kuroda or the Abe administration has been extremely lucky because of this foreigners coming in to buy Japanese equities and pushing the Japanese yen down. But I just wish that Mr. Kuroda would not push his luck too far. Because if Mr. Kuroda really meant to push inflation rate to 2%, and if the Japanese public really believed that inflation is going to be 2%, then what is likely to happen in the market first? Well, they will all dump Japanese government bonds, right? Because that's 10-year Japanese government yielding only 0.6%. If you held on to that thing and inflation really goes up to 2% and beyond, you'd be sitting on massive losses. Now, if you look at all the forecasts coming out of Japanese financial institutions, none of them reach 2%. They're all within 1.3, 1.4, 1.5, within that kind of range. Because if that's the range, then holding on to JGP at 0.6 is not that bad. But if it's really going to 2 and above, then people will dump the JGBs, bond yields will go higher. And if bond yields go higher, what is the likely casualty? Arrow 2. If bond yields start going to 1.5, 2%, people start saying, oh my gosh, no one's buying JGBs. Japan cannot run any more fiscal stimulus. We have to cut the budget deficit, like the situation in Spain or Portugal. And if government had to cut fiscal stimulus when private sector is still saving 8% of GDP at zero interest rates, the whole economy could collapse. And so I wish that Mr. Kuroda would not push his luck too far. And furthermore, and this I will get into my second topic, this QE is easy on the way in, extremely difficult on the way out. And that's what the market is beginning to understand, starting with May 22nd last year, when Chairman Bernanke of the Federal Reserve started mentioning about tapering. So I'd like to move from this to the US case. This is the US flow of funds. And you notice that both the household sector and corporate sector are above zero, which means the US is squarely in balance sheet recession. And this is happening at zero interest rates, suggests that their balance sheet problems are just as serious as the one the Japanese encountered. But the key difference between the United States and Japan, and the US economy now, as you know, are doing relatively better than others, is that US policymakers, by end of 2009, all understood that they are in balance sheet recession. And I know that because I know Chairman Bernanke, and Paul Krugman, Larry Summers, all these people read my book and realized that, oh my gosh, we have the same problem. And we can see that most clearly in their statement, the phrase, fiscal cliff. Fiscal cliff means don't cut your fiscal stimulus now. If you cut the fiscal stimulus, the whole thing will come crashing down. And Chairman Bernanke at that time, and now Chair Janet Yellen, all these people have warned the American public that this is no time to fall off the fiscal cliff. And even though U.S. came mighty close to it on a number of occasions, sequester, government shutdown, and all of that, U.S. managed to stay away from actually falling off the fiscal cliff. And that means every day, U.S. private sector balance sheets are getting cleaner because everybody's paying down debt, as you can see. And so 5 years later, you know, some households, some companies, their balance sheets are more or less presentable. And so some of these people start buying houses, some of them start buying cars, and then the U.S. economy began to improve. So in that sense, I think U.S. learned from the Japanese experience, particularly Japanese experience of 1997. Now, what happened in 1997? I'm sure many of you were there at the time. At that time, Prime Minister Hashimoto, listening to the IMF, OECD, those people who know nothing about anything, told Japan that, hey, you're building bridges to nowhere, roads to nowhere, economy going nowhere, you have an aging population, you better cut the deficit. And I was one of the very few who argued against that whole argument by saying, no, if you cut that, the whole thing will come crashing down. But, you know, I'm just a private sector economist, not even Japanese, and all these other people from around the world said, cut, cut, cut. So he did. 5 quarters of negative growth, complete breakdown in the banking system. And it took Japan nearly 10 years to climb out of that policy mistake, this double dip. And US side studied all of that and says, make sure we don't fall into the 1997 trap. And so they came up with this very sexy term, fiscal cliff, warning people constantly not to fall off the fiscal cliff. And so now they are doing much better. Now, does that mean everything is going rosy from this point onwards? And not quite. because U.S. also did QE, and the massive QE that I mentioned to you earlier, 19 times the required reserves. All that QE that a lot of people talk about sounds great. It's easy on the way in, but it's extremely difficult to come out. But when you look at all the academics' papers written on QE since about starting about 15 years ago, none of them tell you how to come out. All of them tell you how to get in. And this is a very irresponsible situation that that we are stuck with. Now, what I show here is my image of how the long-term interest rates will move with and without QE. The blue line is without the QE. Once the bubble collapses, long-term rates will come down. But if you do the QE on top of it, long rates will probably come down a little faster. And because asset prices are supported a little better, maybe the recovery will happen a little earlier as well. Instead of recovery at T2, it will actually start at T1. But once the recovery starts and people start borrowing money again, then the panic sets in, because there is $2.5 trillion worth of excess reserves sitting in the U.S. banking system now. If people start borrowing money, and the $2.5 trillion means they can increase lending by 19 times the level today, then we'll be facing a massive inflation rate. And so the market will start saying that, the Federal Reserve have to take this thing back. But how did they inject this $2.5 trillion? U.S. did it with the long bonds, meaning buying long-dated U.S. Treasury bonds, long-dated mortgage-backed securities. So what does the Federal Reserve have to sell to take this money back in? The long bonds. But if you sell the long bonds, what is going to happen to the long-term interest rates? It's going to go up. And this is my sense of what is likely to happen. And this is already this has already started May 22nd of last year, when Chairman Bernanke mentioned about tapering. And when long rates go up, that is likely to slow the economy down, especially the housing, especially the auto sectors, because they are very sensitive. And as you saw earlier, U.S. house prices actually stopped rising. And if the economy then starts slowing down, then the government, the Federal Reserve might say, maybe we cannot really do the tapering, or we cannot really remove the funds after all. And then that might actually bring long-term rates down a little bit. But if that then shows that the economy is recovering again, then they might push the long-term rates up again. And we might end up in this very volatile long-term rates at the level much higher than warranted by macroeconomic fundamentals. And if this is then translated to GDP, this is the kind of GDP we may expect to see in the future. Without QE, GDP probably would have fallen a little further and start recovering a little later. But once it starts recovering, everybody in the market, everybody in the economy will be relaxed, because you don't have to worry about central bank dumping this massive quantities of long-term bonds into the market, or tightening monetary policy suddenly. So you can have a fairly smooth recovery, as we all expected in the previous recoveries. But those countries that did the QE, people will be constantly worrying about long-term rates skyrocketing, and probably exchange rates will be stronger than otherwise because of this concern that rates will be higher. You end up having a very much more muted recovery as a result of QE in the system. And when I wrote this report up late last year, I had occasion to visit the Federal Reserve. And I said, this cannot be true. All these bright people at the Federal Reserve must have some ideas how to come out of this mess. And so I presented these to one of the officials at the Fed when I visited the institutions last year, to see whether they can come out and say, of course we have thought about that, and then we're going to do this, this, and this, so you don't have anything to worry about. And if the other side told me that, then I know what to expect from the Fed going forward, right? So I presented this, and the person who was looking at this says, oh no, it's now my problem, was all I heard. And so, and I also wanted to check one more thing with the official at the Fed, and that is that, you know, sitting in Nomura office, I tried to read as much as possible on QE, written by academic economists, but of course, you know, I'm just one person, I cannot cover everything. So I just throw this idea at this person and say, now, I read a lot of paper about how to get into the QE, but I haven't seen a single paper how to come out of the QE from academic economists. Have you seen one? And this person said, no, I haven't seen one either. Which means we are really in the dark. Everything is trial and error from this point onward, because there's no theoretical guidance as to how we come out of these things. And the fact that they did with a long bond makes everything so much more difficult. And I say this because Bank of Japan, under Mr. Shirakawa and the previous governors, actually forecasted all of this and said, if we do, so we have to do it at the short end, and we have to do with private papers. So when the Bank of Japan did the QE from 2001 to 2006, you saw that in my earlier chart, my first chart, that was removed very, very simply, because at that time, BOJ asked the banks to issue 3 months paper, 3 months notes. And the BOJ would buy those 3 months notes, then that would inject the reserves in the banking system. And they massively injected to 7 times the required reserves. And then when they wanted to end this program, all they had to do is not reinvest the proceeds. Right? If you don't invest the reinvest the proceeds, 3 months later, all of these things mature. And when they mature, what does the private sector banks have to do? Well, since the owner now is the Bank of Japan, they have to take down their current account balances within the Bank of Japan and pay the amount to the Bank of Japan, which means it reduced the excess reserves in the banking system. So within 3 months, the whole thing disappeared without a trace, because they knew that this kind of problem would happen if you did at the long end. But this time, Chairman Bernanke and Governor Marvin King wanted to have even more punch into QE by conducting these operations at the long end. But if you do at the long end, and if you then use government papers instead of private sector papers, even if those government papers mature in your holdings, that will only increase government balances with the, let's say, Federal Reserve to the Federal Reserve. It doesn't reduce private sector balances or the excess reserves in the banking system. It only reduces the government balances at the central bank. And so mortgage-backed securities part, well, to the extent that mortgage-backed securities are basically private money, if they mature, then that will actually reduce the excess reserves in the banking system. But all these treasury holdings will not do that. And so we are going to have a huge problem going forward handling this issue. And I don't think it's no coincidence that Federal Reserve decided to start tapering December of last year. When you look at the US inflation rate December of last year, it was only 1.2%. You know, that's a shocking thing, right? They're supposed to hit 2% inflation rate in all of their QE actions. And at 1.2, they decide to turn the steering wheel. Why? Because when you think about it, if you wait until inflation rate is actually 2%, what will happen when you then start tapering? If the inflation rate is 1.2, which is almost zero, this whole forward guidance of zero interest rates is still credible with the market participants. And if you start tapering with your yield curve anchored at zero, then the possibility of long-term interest rates going sky high is limited, because short end, this is still anchored at zero. But if you wait until inflation rate is 2, short-term is no longer anchored at zero. It's going to be 2% or higher, and everybody will expect short-term interest rates to go much higher. And so if you lose the anchor at the short end, God knows where the long end will go. And I think they start thinking in those terms and thought that maybe they have to cut their program when inflation is still close to zero. And so when you think about this QE, you know, it's easy on the way out, and it's, you know, you can always write another line and say, the stock market wants another QE from Mr. Crowder or whatever. But when you think it through, what we have to face after the fact, you know, it's not such a great idea after all. And Federal Reserve, well, some of you have been following Chairman Bernanke's statements. Well, the chairman actually said, oh, we don't have to sell the long bonds. We can still normalize interest rates without Federal Reserve reducing its balance sheets. How do you do that? Well, you pay interest on the $2.5 trillion. If you pay enough interest on the $2.5 trillion, the money will not go out of the bank, go out to the private sector. It will stay with the Federal Reserve bank account. But then you look at the cost of this program, right? It's $2.5 trillion out there. If you have to pay 2% on that, you're talking about $50 billion every year. And this $50 billion is every year until this money is somehow removed from the system. And this $50 billion will be addition to Federal Reserve budget deficit, a federal budget deficit every year. And I'm sure those Republicans who never agree with QE will not look at that very kindly. So they could cause all sorts of problems when somehow a federal budget deficit is increased by $50 billion every year for this reason. And furthermore, if the Federal Reserve held on to that bonds, and if interest rates normalize, what will happen to the capital loss on this long bond that Federal Reserve is holding? And the IMF actually did a calculation on how much loss the Federal Reserve would be sustaining if they held on to those bonds. And the most likely scenario, that they have like three scenarios, but the most likely scenario, Federal Reserve will be sitting on losses equivalent to 3% of US GDP, which is about $500 billion. So Federal Reserve is $500 billion underwater. How will that play to the people who hold US dollar assets around the world? How would the Chinese feel? How would the Russians feel? How would the Arabs feel when the dollar is issued by the central bank that is $500 billion underwater? Well, some academics say, oh, it doesn't matter. If Federal Reserve is bankrupt, the central bank is bankrupt, doesn't matter as long as it conducts its monetary policy responsibly. But human race, in our 5,000 years of history, never trusted a currency not tied to the gold until 1971. That's when Nixon shock came in and the dollar and the gold was decoupled. And that means only 30 years. And of the first 10 years, US actually had a double-digit inflation rate, and they had to operate as though they are on the gold standard, to use Greenspan's term. So when you think about all of these problems, you know, if the US Congress then give $500 billion to the Federal Reserve, you know, capital injection, then of course everything will be fine. And when those long bonds mature, if they held on to the long bonds until the end and they actually matured in the holdings of the Federal Reserve, then the capital loss would not be an issue, and then this money can be returned to the government. But all of that is going to be a big issue, I think. And at that point, people start looking back and said, wow, all these QEs that we put in wasn't such a good idea after all. Now, I don't know whether I'm covering all the possibilities of how to get out of the QE. If you have a better ideas, I'd love to hear from you. And I'm sure people at the Federal Reserve and Bank of Japan and Bank of England, those three central banks that put in the QE, will be grappling with this problem going forward. But I think that is going to be the issue for United States first. And if UK and Japan comes out of its balance sheet recession, then they'll be facing that as well. And this trauma problem that after repairing balance sheets for so many years, no one wants to borrow anymore. This will be a global problem. It's a Japanese problem now, but I think it's going to be a global problem because they are going through such a long period of deleveraging. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you for this insight. And usually, down, usually, you add a sitting. We'd like to open the floor for questions and answers. So if you like to raise any question, raise your hand, please. Anthony and Stefano and you. Mr. Koo accepted to extend a little bit our sessions beyond 2 o'clock.
Anthony Rowley, Singapore Business Times. Nice to see you again, Richard. This is a complex debate, so let me try to ask a simple question. If the real economy improves, both in US and Japan and so on, as a result of QE, how far does that reduce the problem? In other words, things like corporate profits rise, government revenue rises. Does that help to get out of the QE trap in itself? And if not, why not? And very quickly, I'm sure you're aware that people like Jesper Cole of JP Morgan, argues exactly the opposite to you. You say no one's borrowing. He says that in Japan, borrowing is actually rising again, both by the corporate sector and the household sector, and this is very good news. So which is it? Is borrowing rising or is it not?
Well, the second question is easier to answer. The borrowing is rising, but it's rising from a very low level, and not much is spent really on productive capacity at the moment. So some people got a little excited about QE, decided to buy some real estate. That kind of borrowings are rising. But as the data shows, it's nowhere near enough to allow government to move on to fiscal consolidation. And on the first issue, of course, QE is not going to be a problem until the economy starts showing signs of life. Until economy recovers, until private sector demand is back, money multiplies negative at the margin. And so no matter how much money you put into the banking system, nothing happens. And at that time, I think people should have made a decision that, hey, we're putting in 10 times, 15 times, 19 times, nothing's happening. Maybe it's a wrong disease that we're trying to treat. But they kept on doing it, thinking that at some point there'll be some threshold or such a point and then things will happen. But now I think we are stuck with a problem. Now, the recovery help, well, it's because people are beginning to clean up their balance sheets, start borrowing money, that we run into this problem. And you mentioned that if the QE, as a result of QE, the economy begin to recover. Well, I don't buy that line either. If people are just paying down debt, and once the debt payment, once the balance sheets are finally repaired, that's the time they start thinking forward. But while they're paying down debt, by definition, money multiplier is negative, and so QE had no role to play. And so it's not the result of the QE that economy is recovering. It's more of the other policies, the fiscal stimulus and others, that allow private sector to repair its balance sheets. It's only the little bit on so-called portfolio rebalancing effect that QE might have helped by keeping some assets from falling even further. Well, I'm using the term paying down debt to mean both increasing savings as well as actually paying down debt. And Japanese companies are no longer paying down debt per se, but there's increasing savings. And for our purposes, it's the same thing. And macroeconomically, they are the same thing.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. My name is Stefano Carrer, the Italian Economic Daily newspaper, Sole 24 Ore. You said that Europe has made all the mistakes that Japan previously made. Now there are rumors that the European Central Bank could possibly embark in quantitative easing, especially if the deflationary pressure will increase and the economic recovery will not materialize. So do you think that this will be another mistake or not from the European Central Bank? And the second question, your fascinating idea of trying to force in some way the private savings in weaker European countries to stay in local debt market instead of financing Germany. I mean, how is possible to implement this this idea? Because it seems that really the key for saving Europe and so on, but how is possible to implement this kind of barrier in moving money inside Europe? Thanks.
Well, I guess I do have to talk about Europe after all. Because in order to answer his question, I have to explain to you how I view Europe. So if I may quickly go through European slides. This is how Europe looks like. And this is, Europe has so many countries. So what I did is put all the private sector lines into one line. So this red line is for Spain. The green line is Ireland. That's the entire private sector of those countries. And when you look at that, during the bubble days, when the house prices are skyrocketing, they were all in the negative range. Now they're all in the positive range at the lowest interest rates in modern European history. So Europe is squarely in balance sheet recession, just like in Japan, just like in the United States. And when you look at the size of private sector savings in all of these economies, Ireland, the private sector is saving 13% of GDP. Spain, 11%, Portugal, 8%, they are far larger than the budget deficits. Budget deficits on this column. But no one seems to be paying attention to these numbers. Everybody's paying attention to the budget deficit and says, oh, they're too big. But if the private sector is saving more than that, the budget deficit under these circumstances is actually too small to stabilize those economies. And so, but why are they having this problem? Why these people are having so-called fiscal crisis when the private sector is saving more than the budget deficit? Only in Greece, where the reverse is true, that the private sector savings is actually not enough to cover the budget deficit. But all the others, private sector savings is enough to cover their budget deficit. Well, they're having this problem because interest rates in all of these economies actually skyrocketed after the crisis. So instead of coming down, as in United States, UK, and even in Sweden, interest rates actually went up. Why did interest rates went up in Spain when the private sector savings is actually bigger than the budget deficit? Very simple reason. If you're a fund manager in United States, UK, or Japan, and if you're under certain rules from your authorities that you cannot take too much foreign exchange risk, you cannot take too much current principal risk, meaning you cannot put all your money in stocks, that you have to have some fixed income, and your private sector as a group is not borrowing money, where can you put your money? The only place you can put your money is in the government bond. So that's why bond yields come down to these ridiculously low levels during what I call balance sheet recessions. This is not a bubble. This is what you expect during the balance sheet recession. And this is a natural corrective mechanism of the economy in balance sheet recession by encouraging government bond yields to come down, encourage government to have larger fiscal stimulus, keep the income from collapsing, allow private sector to have income to pay down debt, and in due course, private sector balance sheets are repaired, then you fix the government balance sheets. It has to be in that order. But in Europe, that did not work. Spain, Ireland, those bond yields went sky high because of the very simple reason. If you're a Spanish fund manager in exactly the same situation, you don't have to buy Spanish government bonds. You can buy German government bond, the Dutch government bond, the Finnish government bond, because they're all in the same currency zone. So fund manager in Spain has 17 choices, whereas fund manager in US, UK, and Japan each have only one. And so what worked outside Europe doesn't work inside Europe. And so that's why I've been suggesting, as I mentioned a little earlier, that maybe another measure should be introduced to make sure that some money in Spain will go to Spanish government bond market instead of to the German government bond market. And so I've been suggesting different risk weights that if you're a fund manager in Spain, if you buy your own Spanish government bond, your risk weight is still zero. But if you buy someone else's government bond, even within the same Eurozone, your risk weight will be higher. In that case, you will direct at least some portion of the domestic savings to the domestic government bond market. And if that happens and these bond yields come down, then there will be no more crisis. And so I've been pushing that line. You may say that, well, how do you make sure that this happens? Well, this measure doesn't cost German taxpayer a single pfennig. Oh, whatever you call a penny. So there's no reason why German taxpayers should oppose this scheme. If anything will cost the German taxpayers will be very upset because they think they did everything right and then these guys in the Southern Europe screw themselves up. Why do we have to pay for their mistakes? But that's not exactly how it's happening. It's happening because of this crazy capital flight problems. And this capital flight problem actually have a little bit of history too. And this history goes back to year 2000 when Germany had a massive bubble, the so-called telecom bubble. And you know, German people, like the Japanese people, are very serious types. And if they have nothing else to worry about, they worry about the skies falling on them. But something happened to the Japanese 24 years ago. And something happened to the Germans 14 years ago. They went crazy over the tech bubble. And this Neue Markt went from 1,000 to 9,600 and came crashing down, lost 97% of its value, and the market was disbanded and had a new name called TechDAX. This devastated German balance sheets. The result, this is a German flow of funds. The German company, well, German households were saving, very conservative people, but German companies were appropriately borrowing. But once the tech bubble burst, you see that German companies went straight into the positive range, meaning that they were all saving money instead of paying down debt. Household also increased their savings massively. By 2005, 2006, these guys are saving 10% of GDP at the lowest interest rates they have ever seen. Against that, but because Germany were in the Eurozone, they were in a balance sheet recession, they're supposed to have used fiscal stimulus, but they couldn't use the fiscal stimulus because of the 3% rule. The 3% rule was put in by German government as well. So they had to stick with the 3% rule. Private sector is saving 7% of GDP, the economy is collapsing. And so European Central Bank then had to come in to help the German economy by bringing interest rates from 4.75 all the way to 2%, the lowest in the post-war period, tried to save the German economy. But there's no reason for German economy to respond because no one in Germany was borrowing money, as you saw earlier. Companies are paying down debt, households are paying down debt. And to see this more drastically, this is the German household sector. The way that this chart is put together, the blue line is how much they are saving. And orange line is how much they are borrowing. And you notice that until the bubble, German households were saving money, but they were also borrowing money to buy houses, cars, whatever. But once the bubble burst, this borrowing disappears completely. So German households just refuse to borrow, try to repair their balance sheets. So savings goes up dramatically here. And this is the reason why German house prices collapsed 10% at the 2% interest rates, the lowest interest rates in the post-war period, because no one was borrowing money to buy houses. But then you look at the other countries. This is Spain. Spanish households, also very conservative people, but when they saw 2% interest rates, the interest rates that even their grandparents haven't seen, they couldn't resist. So they went in a typical textbook reaction. If you see, if you have a clean balance sheets, interest rates come down to these ridiculously low levels, what are you supposed to do? You're supposed to buy real estate with borrowed money. So they borrowed money, tons of money, and that's the housing bubble you saw in Spain. This is Ireland too. Very conservative to begin with, but when they saw 2% interest rates to save the German economy, they couldn't resist either. So they borrowed tons of money, and that's how the Irish bubble happened. Now, in addition to this, so what this means is that ECB's low interest rate policy worked beautifully for the other countries, not Germany. But beautifully means there are so many borrowers responded to low interest rates. Now, if there are borrowers borrowing money, what happens to money supply? Money supply increases. So this is the money supply increase outside Germany. This is money supply increase in Germany. Because no one's borrowing money, so money supply grew very, very slowly. Here, everybody's borrowing money, so money supply grew very rapidly. At the end of 8 years, European non-German money supply is up to 217. We take 1990 as 100. German money supply is only 156. Now, what will that do to the wages and prices? Naturally, wages and prices are much higher here than in here. So the so-called competitiveness gap that a lot of people talk about has a lot to do with this factor, that German money supply was growing very slowly, and the economy, of course, was doing very poorly. So wages and prices grew very slowly. Whereas in other parts, wages and prices were going up very rapidly because money supply was growing very rapidly and monetary easing was working. So this whole idea that, well, we in Germany did all these hard structural reform, pension reform, labor reform, Schroeder 2010 program, and look at those Southern Europeans, they're lazy, having great time next to the, having great wine and, you know, great food and chasing lovely girls, whatever the case may be. You know, that's not the whole story by any stretch of imagination. This part has a very large part to it. It's a macroeconomic lack of synchronization. Germany was in balance sheet recession. Everybody else was outside. But central bank had to save the German economy. Everybody else went on the bubble. And under the circumstances, you get this kind of competitiveness gap automatically, as it were. And the German economy, how did it come out of this mess? By exporting your way out. If you are competitive and everybody else is not competitive, this is how you come out, right? So this is the German trade surplus against the rest of Europe. Trade surplus increased dramatically. Against US, little bit of improvement. Against Asia, zero improvement. And so I would argue that we should allow economies within the Eurozone in balance sheet recession to run larger budget deficit with a full blessing from EU. Now, if the EU ECB gives a full blessing and the different risk weights that I mentioned to you are also in place, then that will encourage the money from those economies to go to their own government bond. And that keeps the economy from collapsing. That will allow ECB to run monetary policy without this distortion coming from one or two countries that are in balance sheet recessions. Interest rate wouldn't have to be lowered to such ridiculously low levels. And to put it more on top of all this, German banks, during the period when Germany was in balance sheet recession, there was private sector savings, 10% of GDP coming to the German banks. Of that 10%, German private sector is only, German public sector is borrowing only 3%, or slightly more than 3%. So the remaining 7%, German banks had to lend to someone else. So they had to lend to the peripheral countries, they had to buy the toxic CDOs from the American banks, and that's how they got into problems later on. But if the German government were borrowing that money, German banks were simply lent to the German government and didn't have to lend to the peripheral countries or buy CDLs in the United States, so everybody would have been better off. And so I think the key distortion in Europe comes from this 3% rule, which makes Europe unable to handle balance sheet recessions. And in my 2003 book titled Balance Sheet Recession from John Wiley, I mentioned that if US, Japan, and Europe fell into balance sheet recession, Europe will have the most problems because of this 3% rule. And I think that's the way it's now unfolding in Europe today. And so if we just change one part of the Maastricht Treaty by saying, okay, if the EC or EU panel of experts determine that a certain country is in balance sheet recession, then that country should be allowed to run larger budget deficit with a full blessing from the EU ECB. And that will allow, and by balance sheet recession, they have their own savings inside the country that can finance it. And that will make everybody, the whole system work much better. In fact, I believe that there's only two things that needs to be corrected in Europe. One is the different risk weights, and the other is this provision, a new provision in the Maastricht Treaty. If those two are in place, I think euro can function beautifully without this euro bonds or fiscal unification or whatever. All we need is those two corrections to make euro work. And they don't cost German taxpayers anything. That's the most important part that we have to emphasize.
I think this might be the last question.
I know you love to talk about Europe, but sorry, I have a question about Japan. I'm Martin Fritz, working for the German magazine Wirtschaftswoche. Two questions. One is, you didn't mention the word deflation. So could you say something about QE and deflation? Is it possible to kill deflation with QE in Japan? And the second thing is, I think one unique other part about the QE in Japan is it's done while we are not in a recession. It's done while the economy is actually growing. So it's not against the recession, it's against deflation. So could you elaborate on that?
Well, you're very sharp-eared for noticing that I did not talk much about deflation. I hate that word because it's only a symptom of the problem. It's not the reason we have these problems in Japan today. First of all, average Japanese, 80 to 90% of the Japanese, if you ask them, are we in deflation or not? They will say, no, we are not in deflation, we are in inflation. And that can be certified by this Japanese cabinet survey of average Japanese people, as well as the Bank of Japan survey, which indicate that 80 to 90% of the people simply said, we are not in deflation. All these years, not just recently, but all these years, because those expenses that relates to their living, like energy, the rent, all of those, never really fell all that much, and some actually went up. It's like color television and computers that came down dramatically in value. But you know, you cannot eat computers, right? So living expenses didn't really fall. And the fact that they didn't fall, or the average people don't think that they are in deflation, means they were not delaying purchases. If you believe you are in deflation, then you delay your purchases because you think things are cheaper a little in the future, and that is supposed to be bad for the economy. But if 80 to 90% of the population never felt that they are in deflation, then that part was never an issue either. So what is the issue? The key issue is that private sector as a group is not borrowing money. That's the issue. And they're not borrowing money even at zero interest rates. And that makes money multiplier negative at the margin, and all the monetary policy tools fail to produce results. And I think it failed, I don't think QE has done any good in the United States or UK either. Because if you look at those monetary aggregates that I indicated to you earlier, none of those countries you actually see green line moving higher, meaning that all the QE that was put in basically got stuck in the banking system and didn't come out. And so if they didn't come out, how can you have inflation? And actually, U.S. inflation is coming down, European inflation rate is coming down because the money is not really entering the private sector. And that's because of the balance sheet problems. So I would argue that in this kind of situation, and only in this kind of situation, you have to use fiscal policy, government borrowing and spending money to keep the income of the private sector from collapsing. And that by keeping the income from collapsing, private sector has the income to pay down debt. And once they repair their balance sheets, then you reverse the order. You allow the government to repair its balance sheets and let the private sector borrow money. But we are not in that stage yet. We are still on this stage. So I don't think ECB should be the one to carry the burden. It should be the government and the fiscal policy to carry the day. Now, I have to make one condition to it, and that is that when we have a financial crisis, you know, when the bubble bursts, two problems happen, the borrower's problem and the lender's problem. The borrower's problem I call balance sheet recession. The lender's problem is called financial crisis because the banks go bankrupt. And in that lender's problem, central bank has to act and has to act decisively. So I have nothing against QE1 or what is known as QE1 around the world, because at that time, if the central bank did not play the lender of last resort, the whole thing would have collapsed. So that part I have nothing against. But QE2 and beyond, where they thought they could do something to the macroeconomy by pumping this money into the system, I think we are going to pay a very high price for it going forward.
Thank you. I think this wraps up our event. Anthony, you have something? Very, very quickly, please. Thank you.
The Bank of Japan was a pioneer in quantitative easing. They pulled out of it in 2006. The Japanese economy didn't collapse, as far as I remember. So can other countries learn from the Japanese experience and how to end QE?
Well, I thought I already answered that.
Did you? I'm sorry, I
missed it. No, BOJ, knowing that if you played at the long end of the government bond market, it would be very difficult to rescind QE. That's why they did everything at the short end, asking banks to issue notes so that they can end it very quickly.
Thank you very much, Mr. Ku, for your insights. And this wraps up our event. I would like to give you a 1-year honorary membership in our club. I hope you come back next year and tell us how the effect of the tax is appeared in the Japanese economy. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for coming and have a nice evening.